And now let's bring in our next guest, and that's David Bonson. He is the Chief Investment Officer at Bonson Group. Welcome to the show, David. Appreciate you being here today. You know what? We're going to kind of pivot a little bit away from markets and get into a little bit of the commodity space. We've seen oil prices jump significantly this year, but they've started to consolidate around that $60 barrel level. The bull case demand is ready to take off, but production's coming offline after May, along with COVID lockdowns, started to stabilize the crude market. What are your expectations here for oil?
Well, I don't have expectations for the price of oil because we want an investment theme that isn't dependent on the commodity price. That's why the midstream space, the pipelines that transport crude oil, but you can't forget natural gas in the story either, is to us a much more investable theme. I think you're exactly right. There's a little consolidation here around 60, and that's kind of a very healthy spot because this is very profitable right here for producers, and yet it is not so high that it erodes demand from consumers. So you start getting too high above 70, you get some demand erosion. You get below 50, you start getting marginal profit suffrage from the producers.
Yeah, and you mentioned that you're interested more in that midstream space, and one of the names that you've got is an ETF, relatively new one. UMI is a ticker symbol, at more actively managed ETF I'm looking at here. So what's your take here on UMI?
Well, look, I think it's a profoundly innovative product in the marketplace because there are passive ETFs that exist in this space that are largely centered around MLPs, and they force a lot of low quality from the index into the ETF product. And then there are kind of different actively managed approaches, usually separately managed accounts. An ETF like this UMI that allows for the best of all worlds. It's a single ticker. It doesn't create a K-1, which investors, clients, and CPAs like. And yet it enables you to get both the MLPs, the Canadians, the C Corps, all in one security, but actively managed so you can filter for quality, for the debt metrics you want, for the cash flow coverage you want, which is really very important to us.
Yeah, and if you take a look at this space and the expectations moving forward, you know, we've got individual tax increases coming up. We've got the administration moving towards a more green energy bias. I mean, what are your expectations for this space moving forward? Because it seems like there's quite a few headwinds here.
Yeah, I think the only people that could believe a movement to green energy is bad for natural gas would be people that don't understand natural gas. You've had a complete and total reduction of greenhouse emissions as we have moved more and more to natural gas to power electricity versus coal, which is clearly a bigger carbon emitter. I don't believe for a second that the Biden administration moves towards more green energy ideas is going to take away the need for oil and gas to actually feed and actually warm people in our society. And I don't think anybody wants to see the awful things that could happen from that reduced access to energy. And natural gas is going to be a bigger part of the growth story. But the irony from an investment standpoint, putting aside all the environmental and scientific aspects, the irony is anything they do to limit new building of energy infrastructure that is fossil oriented makes the value of present energy infrastructure assets more sustainable. It creates a value as they limit the expansion of new pipelines. We simply cannot afford to transport all the oil and gas that needs transporting in our country via rail and truck, which last time I checked remains far more environmentally vulnerable.
Yeah, and those tax increases for the individual, is that going to have any negative impact?
Well, I really believe it's important for people to wait to see what tax increases actually get passed, because there's been absolutely nothing that is what was campaigned on. I use as an example in my DividendCafe.com daily writing today that the administration campaigned on a corporate tax minimum with $100 million EBITDA that was going to affect about 1,800 companies. The plan he put out last week set the bar at $2 billion. It's only going to affect about 45 companies. So the disconnect between campaign rhetoric and real legislation because of sausage making and because of a 50-50 Senate, and there being at least a couple moderate, sane Democrats, I think it really does limit what they can get done in terms of marginal tax increases. I expect there will be some movement, but I don't expect it's going to be substantial.
Not surprising there on the political front that we get some changes in some of that rhetoric. Appreciate the conversation here, David, and thank you very much. That's David Bahnsen. He's a chief investment officer at Bahnsen Group.